I'm Rubi Roberts and this is SWN.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast, the debut of the SWN on tour podcast, or whatever I'm calling it. I am your host as always, Billy, and unfortunately, since the last episode, since the last road trip episode, I got a new car. Unfortunately, it also means I can't put the phone on my little dashboard because it dips too low. You'll just see the top of the roof. So every so often, you'll see my face. And oh my God, I look so fat. So first episode, we are off to Elgin. I'm in Elgin. We're off to Wrestling Showdown for W3L. And the fun thing about this is that you'll get to see my whole journey because I have just left my house and you'll see how far away the town hall is from my house. So it's gonna be a fun show because there's two matches announced for W3L Wrestling Showdown at Elgin Town Hall. There's a W3L Heavyweight Championship match. It's Taylor Bryden defending against Luke King Sharp. And there's also Rubi Roberts versus Katya. And I don't know if that was going to be a Seven Deadly Sins match or what have you. Also announced to be Krieger, Saqib Ali, and hometown favourite Meyhem. So there's a lot to happen on this show. So I'm looking forward to it. This is the first of, I've got three shows over 2 weeks, something like that, because I've got tonight in W3L. Tomorrow I'm in Peterhead for Community Pro Wrestling. And then on the 5th, I'm in Aberdeen for WrestleZone Battle of Nations. So it's a lot of wrestling, which is why I'm doing I'm prioritising this on-tour season, kind of in between. I'll throw in some interviews. We've recorded one with Tommy Raiden that'll go out the week after this episode. And we've got an episode with Tommy Cross coming up as well that I have recorded as yet. I'll record that on Monday, which is going to be quite a busy day because I plan to record the WrestleZone podcast as well. So there's a lot going on for SWN and the SWN podcast, but right now it's going to go see some E3L and I'm absolutely buzzing. So like I said, I don't know how long this episode will be. I was actually supposed to have my brother with me today, but he's cried off ill, unfortunately. He was one of the victims last week after my son's birthday party. Everyone seemed to come down with norovirus. And he was one of the victims of that, and he's not quite recovered. I'm not feeling particularly great, but, you know, everything is still where it needs to be in my body. Nothing's forcing itself out at speed. So, we're all good. Fine enough to go to the show. I'm hoping, I can't guarantee it, because I haven't really pre-arranged anything, but I'm hoping to maybe grab an interview for the interim, like in the middle of the episode. If not, it's going to be this, and then it'll be the montage, and then it'll be and then it'll be my thoughts after the show, possibly a bit at the end as well in the studio, and this will be out on the following Friday. So it's going to be a nice quick one, I think, just to kind of ease myself back into the season. Just did the first interview with Tommy Raiden, like I say, on Wednesday. So it's going to be one where I'm kind of easing myself back in, because after the show with the Day of Birth Bonanza, and then I did the show with Jan and kind of with Stan. I'm just kind of, easing myself back into doing some seasons and doing the podcast. So that's quite cool. Right, that's it. Told you. 3 minutes it took me to get here. Not even 3 minutes. And the queue is forming. So the next thing you'll probably see will be, I'll do a little thing on the queue. And then montage time. So this could be a very quick episode. Have a good one. There's the queue. Everyone's starting to get ready. Doors open in, well, now, so I better actually go. Let's go. Check that. Got a billboard and everything.
Let's go. I wake up to a little bit of drool on my pillow, feel like it's gonna be a bad day. Yeah, I'm tired of shit, and the coffee ain't hit yet, damn, ain't that great. I don't wanna go to work cause my boss is a jerk and I'm not even that paid. I need a change in my life cause I don't feel alive and there's nothing that makes me happy. Oh, hold my beer for a minute. I'm about to quit my job, cash in for a ticket. I'm going on a trip and I don't plan to visit. I'm gonna stay there till I feel like I'm winning all. And this is just the beginning. I need a big change, help me feel like living. I need a big swing, home runs I'm hitting. And I'll never look back, moving on till I get it all. And we all got dreams, we all want things. But what you gonna do for it? How you gonna move for it? What you gonna be? I do believe we can do anything. But what you gonna do for it? How you gonna move for it? What you gonna be? This is my game to play, to claim a brand new name, oh. And I ain't gonna lie to you, I'm a bit nervous that I might screw everything up that I've ever done. But what's the point of living if you ain't having fun? I guess I'll try this, try that, might miss, gotta find what I'm good at. I guess I look here, look there, over where am I scared, where am I at? I gotta make it in this life, whatever makes me happy, know I'm doing things right. Sipping in the summer on a goose and Sprite. What you gonna be? I do believe we can do anything. But what you gonna do for it? How you gonna move for it? What you gonna be?
Here I am, post-show of W3L in Elgin. I'm joined by Meyhem Brooks, Rubi Roberts, past guests, and Saqib Ali for the first time, despite ghosting me on Twitter. So, how's everyone doing?
Excellent. So at arm, but great.
Yeah.
Victorious.
I don't know what it is about Elgin and W3L though, because there always seems to be drama with the late start and all that kind of stuff.
But... oh, so many car accidents on the way here, yeah. You can't account for Scottish traffic.
Amazing, but yeah, that's why I'll just jump in just before I go home, because I'm 3 minutes away and you're probably about the same, to be honest. Mm-hmm. But no, I hope you had a good time, and we'll see you in October.
Excellent, see you then.
Yeah. So, thank you for coming. It was my few words, I like it.
Yeah. I just want to say about the 5 minutes before my match.
Yeah, to be fair, 5 minutes before his match,
right now
smashed it.
Yeah, no.
Anyway, I'll leave you guys to it. Listen, a couple minutes, and enjoy the trip back.
Great to see you guys.
So that was it. I'm back at the car. It is raining outside. How dare it? I'm hoping stuff works. So it was a really great show for W3L. See, I've got some pictures, got some videos, and I got not even a minute with Saqib Ali, Meyhem Brooks, and Rubi Roberts, which is nice. Great to see them. First time seeing Rubi Roberts in action. You can't see me. I'm totally turned to John Cena. And it was a lot of fun. It was just a really fun show. The doors are open late due to car crashes and what have you, as you heard Rubi say. There was then electrical issues, it seems, because during the main event, the lights went out and the lights came back on and then the lights went out. At one point it was fans with their phone lights on that were lighting the match, which was really cool, to be honest. It was a cool visual to see. But I'll probably do a wee in-studio bit after all this, and I can kind of break down the matches a little bit more, but the results will already be on the SWN site probably by the time that this date ends. But it was just a cracking show from W3L once again. Of course, I mean, it's not perfect. There's some matches maybe a bit rougher than others, but in general, I had an absolute blast. And that's the most important thing. I pay my money and I enjoy the wrestling. And this is the first of two shows in 2 days. Looking forward to going up to Peterhead. Hopefully I'll get some like road trip stuff, because I want to go to Bonbon. But you won't see that for another 2 weeks, I think. I think that's how the... I don't know. I can't remember how my schedule is working so far. But, yeah, we've got to see some great matches. The main event was chaotic, as you'd expect it to be, with Luke King Sharp and Taylor Bryan. We've got the reveal, the return of Mike Musso, and then they announced a show in October, which is going to have... sorry, spoiling the announcements here. But hopefully they'll be announced by the time that this comes out. We've got Joey Legend and Johnny Storm coming to Elgin. Joey Legend's been to Elgin before, but it's always good to see just Joe in a wrestling ring. And Meyhem Brooks will be taking on Craig Stevens for the Breakout Championship. And you know what? Gut feeling? I think this is the one. This is the one where we see victorious Meyhem Brooks, and we see a new Breakout Champion. WTL, because it'll be the season premiere of Wrestling Showdown, but they do, like I said, they do a really good spread of variety. Like I say, not all matches maybe were great. Some were as receptive as others with the crowd, but the children enjoyed it, which is, to be honest, they're the most important thing when it comes to family friendly wrestling. It's what the kids react to, and what they enjoy. And me being a cynical 33-year-old man, my opinion could be jaded by experience, but I had a great time. So I'm looking forward to seeing what W3L have an offer in October. I'm hoping I have to add that. I have to add that to my lineup of road trip shows. See how I can drag to that. See if my brother will be okay for that. If not, I'll see if Kelly can pull our stuff away from our son for a couple hours on a Sunday. But yeah, I'm taking the long way around, so I've got more than 3 minutes of startup. Like I said, I'll do a little bit afterwards, which you'll probably see in a moment, while I'm driving home in the rain. And yeah, next up is Peterhead for Community Pro Wrestling at Peterhead Football Club. I have no idea where that is, so it could be an adventure in itself. I'm sure I'll find things and stuff to do and that, because I'm leaving quite early, so I could one find it. And like I say, I want to try and get to some places in Peterhead at the time. But maybe, just maybe, I'll get an interview or two. A couple minutes here and there. We're on the road. We're on a road trip. This has been a fun episode. Like I said, I'll do a bit afterwards. Like I'll I'm like after going to wrestling shows, I just ramble for a good couple minutes. But yeah, it's been an absolute blast. Worth coming to. Worth the whole 3-4 minute drive to the town hall. Really nice venue, nice echoey venue. And I think at this point, they oversold the second row tickets for the venue space. So I think I would hazard a guess that if they sell as well as they have for this show, they could open some of the balcony sections, which will be quite cool and quite epic. It'd definitely just be the sides, not the back bit, because you can barely see anything at the best of times. You just see the stage only. So you see the entrances, but not the actual matches itself. But that's me home. I took a long way around, like I said, but I am home. This has been a really fun first road trip for the SWN podcast season 6 road trip, whatever I'm calling it. Let's take it to the aftermath when I'm sitting in a nice warm studio, aka my office. So yeah, great. Oh, this is awkward. And we're back in the studio, back here at SWN Towers. For those that are unaware, and people that go onto Twitter and or wherever it is, X, this is the second time I'm recording this particular section. There is a version on Patreon which has whatever words I said earlier this week. I think it was Monday I recorded that particular bit. And when I took the video file off Zoom, put it all together, thought it was really clever, put it up, uploaded it, montage in, all nice, it all looked good. Then I went onto YouTube, just out of curiosity, I had 5 more edits to do, just see how it's going. The intro glitched, so the Ruby Roberts bit, that hopefully you'll see at the start, it glitched into the next video, so it turned it black and orange, which, you know, it's fitting for Ruby to do that, but it's not what I really wanted. And then when I did this bit, I thought, that's fine. I can sort that. That's no bother. I can sort that. And then when I got to this bit, my face froze. So after like 5 minutes in, so you could hear it, but you couldn't actually see me doing anything. And you know what? I know I'm not totally house proud with my editing, but I think after 5 minutes of just my face really still, it is really disconcerting because I could pop back up at any time. Am I a ventriloquist? Who knows? So this is the second time I'm doing this particular section, which, you know, it's fine. I've still got things to say. I'm probably going to repeat stuff. If you're on Patreon, which you can go on to, patreon.com/scottresnet, £1 plus VAT, and you get access to everything. That version's still going to be on there. It's called exclusive, first attempt, etc., etc. But this will be the official version that will go out for everyone to see. Hopefully you're watching it on YouTube or listening to it on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or what have you right now. So that, with that out the way, let's talk about my remembering my thoughts on W3L Wrestling Showdown in Elgin, which took place on Thursday. So you've seen my journey to the venue, which took loads of time. My journey back from the venue, which I had a little bit of a ramble in that. And I've also done a write-up on swnscotland.com where I talked a little bit about my thoughts on each match and what have you. So I'll go through the results here as well, just in case you don't know, for whatever reason you haven't been on the SWN Scotland website, which, I mean, I think you may have at this point. It's probably, if you're on video, it's down in the description somewhere, the link. Go check it out, because that's my baby. That's what I do as my spare time hobby when I'm not doing like the real world and making actual money and all that stuff. This is my sanctuary, is swnscotland.com, where I speak about Scottish wrestling ad nauseum. But the show itself, it was a lot of fun. It was chaotic in the sense of there was the doors open late, there was the Murray Fire van outside, so I thought, oh well, it's an electrics issue maybe it's a fire safety issue, I don't know, maybe they're trying to figure out if they need to get more seats in, they have to open the balcony, who knows. But it seems like it was an electrical issue from judging from the main event. So at that, doors were open about half an hour late. We got in, the place was rammed. Like, there were still seats getting put out. I think possibly second row was oversold because there was orange bands everywhere. I was sat with a few folk that had orange bands. I only bought general. So it was a case of we were just trying to pile in to get a good view. And I got a great view, to be honest. I was near the merch stand at the merch tables. So I got a great view. The photos hopefully do it justice. But I got just an excellent, I could see the entranceway, I could see the ring, and I could see what was happening when fights did come into the crowd. So I was well happy with where I sat, to be honest. But it was really a packed night. And these shows that W3L are putting on in Elgin, they're now coming more than once, they're coming twice a year, which I think is required, really, because it's how you retain an audience. They used to just come once a year, and... Well, for a long time, they used to come once a year, and it would be bog standard kind of family friendly shows. It would be bad guy, good guy, the next one, good guy, bad guy, bad guy from the first match comes out, batters the good guy in the second match, tag team match made of it, right? You know, that's kind of how the shows went. And as the shows have progressed and as they've come to Elgin more frequently, twice a year, like every 6 months, what have you, the crowd of not only kids but adults as well are becoming invested in the storylines, becoming invested in the titles and the characters that come up, and it's paid dividends because they've done the town, the Summer Spectacular, and then they did Bishop Mill last year, and the Summer Spectacular Town Hall, and they did Bishop Mill at the end of the year, and the retention of crowd was very noticeable. It was very noticeable that the crowd that came to the summer Spectacular, which had Taylor Bryden, Doug Williams in the main event, and they had some shaggins with titles. I think Luke King Sharp was champion at the time. The retention of crowd there was very evident in the crowd that was at Bishop Mill Hall in the December. So it's definitely worth them coming a couple times a year. And They came back in July, and again the retention was obvious, and people knew who Taylor Bryden was. People knew, not only from W3L, but from things like WWE Network, and that they knew who Luke King Sharp was. They knew who Krieger was. So it shows that I've seen the journey
Of course, I think they started coming to Elgin in 2009, I think it was. So I got in 2012. That was my first W3L show because I wasn't aware there was wrestling in Elgin before then. And since then, I've seen the progression of the bog standard bought in kind of family show to them actually having the crowd be part of it in a different way. Like, they'd be part of it with the inflatables and you know, the children getting to chop the bad guy and all that kind of stuff. But now they're being let in and being allowed to invest in a character and a story and being part of a narrative on a show. That makes sense? I think it does make sense. So it's that being said, like I said, all that shenanigans with the show started late, doors opening late, what have you, they seem to really have a really tight show. I don't know if a match was possibly dropped or something like that, if something was due to happen, it wasn't, they just didn't have the time. But it was a really tight show, 5 matches, and they had all matches had plenty of positives that I could think of and I enjoyed in some way or form. Some of the crowd didn't enjoy some of the matches as much. They were a bit more quiet, but there was always a moment where they'd go, whoa, or they'd cheer or they'd boo the respective whoever they needed to cheer or boo at that moment. So the wrestlers did their job. And they, any event, even if they were quite quiet during the start, they always had them by the end. So it was the wrestlers did their job well on the night. But yeah, results, I haven't really talked about the results. Let's just do them. So the show opened up with Taylor Bryden doing a little bit of a promo. So it was simple, effective, didn't really need to do an awful lot. I found out later it was more just to kill time, but it was all stuttering anyway. It wasn't like he was, it was clearly padding for time. I told you the stories were coming to the show. You knew that Looking Sharp and Taylor Bryden were going to fight at the end. You had to keep an eye out for Mike Russo, possibly an eye out for Luke Aldridge, and it set up the main event quite nicely. So that was ace. Tormentor came out next after Taylor Bryden left and had this tiny little bit of paper. This tiny little bit. I don't know if anyone's seen Community and they see Senior Chan with this little bit of paper with, I think it's with whatever F's to give. That's kind of how the size of paper was. And Brian Douglas, he read a soliloquy, a novel off this little bit of paper, which all boiled down to Tormentor didn't feel like he was respected last time in Elgin at the Town Hall when he got battered by Nathan Reynolds, and he wanted a fight. He wanted anyone to fight him. And we got Krieger. And I love Krieger. I think he's great. And I think he's a guy who's still got bundles of potential for places. He's just a big dude who is very charismatic as well. So I wish he would be possibly more places. I don't know what the reason is for or not. Maybe it's just timing. Maybe it's just whatever. I don't know. But I would love to see him more places. The only downside to that for Krieger being there is he offered me a high five. I went for the high five and I barely hit the high five. So that's more an embarrassing moment for me. That's just it whiffed against his hand, and that's going to haunt my nightmares forever. And you know, stuff like that does, because I still get haunted by a cold evening in Strathpeffer when it was a triple threat match involving, I think it was Liam Thompson, Kenny Williams, and Noam Dar. I think possibly Noam, it was definitely Noam Dar anyway. I was working quote unquote security for Rock and Wrestle, and went up for it, and I was standing ringside, like put barriers back and all that kind of stuff, you know, all that fun things. And Dar just looked over to me while he was in the ring. I went, high five, and put his hand up, and I tried to jump to get a high five, and I like hit the bottom of his palm. And that was, what was that, 8 years ago, and it still haunts me to this day. Whenever I have a moment of cringe or wanting to die a little bit, that's the moment that comes back. That, and obviously tell Lita I wasn't going to sell an autograph of her on eBay. Yeah, stuff like that. Fun things that you earn that you gain doing all these wrestling things and going to all these shows. Because I think if I've got my numbers correctly, if I keep on like this 10 shows a year I go to, I'm going to hit 100 shows next year, which will be quite cool. Excited to go to my 100th wrestling show. I know that's probably not a lot to a lot of people, because I know people in Glasgow go to ICW every month, or they go to their local promotion once a month or bi-monthly. But it's still cool that I'm be able to hopefully get to 100 shows next year. I think I'm on 80. I think I'll end the year on like 89 or something like that, possibly, with added shows that are hopefully coming up. For like W3L, they're coming back to Elgin in October. I can't remember if I said that in a little outro bit after the show. But yeah, October 22nd, they're due to come, and they've got Johnny Storm and Joey Legend, who we spoke to this week for the SWN podcast. So that'll be coming out on August 23rd. So you can go check that out. So we've got that, and we know there's a title match. Meyhem Brooks will get our shot at the breakout champion, Craig Stevens. And I'm looking forward to that. That has to be that's going to be the big win and the feel-good win for Elgin. And I'm looking forward to it. I'm hoping that's the case. And I'm going to try and get tickets for it. I know I'm at WrestleZone Halloween Hijinks on the 21st. So I'm just going to see what how the timing plays out. I'll see what the show is. If it's an afternoon show, great. Might just that even better. But we'll keep an eye on that and keep updates going. So once the official matches are announced, we'll have them on the website. So after that was Meyhem Brooks. Speaking of Meyhem Brooks, he defeated Hugo Harris by submission. I really enjoyed Hugo Harris's act. It's like a Rick Rude, Rick Martel kind of hybrid character. And I really enjoyed it. He's very good. Very oily, very snake-like when it comes to his demeanor. Like, there's just something so snaky about him. Which works, which people hate. That's great. Grabbed a bathroom mirror, of course, with the... Do I have one nearby? Oh, I do. Hey, excellent. So I grabbed a bathroom mirror just like this and started like, ooh, whenever you put it towards an audience member. Oh, God, is that what I look like? So, yeah, so they did that. That was funny. I just like the cheapness of the mirror as well, which made it all the more hilarious to me. For him being a narcissist, he wasn't like skimping out for a decent mirror. He just bought one from his bathroom, which was funny. Just put that back there. Stop back mirror. I'm back. Right. Yeah, so that's one of Kelly's mirrors that I borrowed there. So I had that. Meyhem Brooks, fan favourite. As soon as he said it was from Elgin, everyone enjoyed him. I like that he's finally embraced a crowd, because first couple times I saw him in Elgin, he was this really closed off Conor McGregor, the big bollocks kind of fighter. And since his match with Craig Stevens, Bishop Mill. That's a lie. Since his match, he had a match with Tormentor at Summer Spectacular, I think. And he really started embracing the crowd and realizing, right, I'm an Elgin. I'm an Elgin guy, Elgin boy. These guys want to cheer me, and I'm going to let them cheer me. So he would bring the crowd in. He would do some clapping. He would tell the crowd to fire him up and all that kind of stuff. And since then, he has been better in the ring, because I think before he relied a bit too much on I'm a wrestler, I'm good at the wrestling, I can kick people, I can grab people, I can throw people down, all that good stuff. But it's getting that character bit is what kids will enjoy, what people that want to come back to the shows will enjoy as well. So once you got that, you become an infinitely better performer. And this match with Hugo Harris, big character. He's got a bit excellent wrestler at the same time. So it worked out really well. Well worked match. And I like that it's, if I'm remembering rightly, Hugo Harris got hit with that, I think it was a Uranagi of some description, or I think it was the Angle Slam. Kicked out with a pinfall, but as soon as he kicked out, Meyhem grabbed his arms and tied him up and put him into a chokehold and tapped out. And I like that quickness and decisiveness that Brooks was like, right, you've kicked out, I've got a backup plan here. And I really like that kind of wherewithal and cerebralness for him. So, fun match. I possibly wrote this in our review, so go check that out on swnscotland.com. There's Triple Threat. It was after the break. Saqib Ali defeated Mark Monroe and Xander Davidson. A fine match. It was just a good triple threat. Nothing really exciting or inoffensive or offensive about it. It was just a really solid triple threat. And the fact that Saqib Ali arrived 5 minutes beforehand, just threw on his gear and went out there, it could have fallen apart so easily. It could have been a match that fell apart. But this day had a great showing, and I enjoyed the match. I really enjoyed the match. So I haven't seen Mark Monroe before. It was all right. Xander Davidson, again, didn't see an awful lot of him because Saqib Ali was such a big character, and he really held the match together. Like I said, considering he only came in 5 minutes beforehand due to traffic, makes it all the more impressive. In the Seven Deadly Sins tournament semi-final, no DQ submission match, Katty defeated Ruby Roberts by TKO, which this was probably one of the matches that was a little bit of a harder sell for an audience. I put it in our review that kids like to shout. They like to shout 1, 2, 3. That's what they like to do. So when you present a submission match, it makes it a bit more difficult. It's a lot more waiting about, and yeah, that's it's just trying to, if a good guy gets the submission on the bad guy, you're going to have to rely on them to the crowd to go tap, tap, tap and all that kind of stuff. So it was a little bit of a harder sell, and it took a little bit of going for Katya and Ruby to get the crowd getting into the match. And through the no DQ element, I don't think they used enough of the no DQ element possibly. Katya brought in some cables. I don't know if that was just the last minute thing they threw the no DQ stuff, but the match was good. It was a good match. It's just, I think the crowd weren't particularly ready for a submission match. You know what I mean? So they weren't as when the match started, but they were happy to boo Katya at the end when she choked out Ruby Roberts with the help of some cables. So the end result was exactly what was required. They were booing Katya, the Russian who thought it was a pinfall for a moment, and everyone had a wee giggle because she didn't understand the rules and all that kind of stuff. So it was a match. The crowd got invested in the end. It was a build up. They were able to build up that kind of story that allowed the crowd to boo Katya at the end. So it all worked out in the end. I'm sure there was a sentence there or a point in there somewhere. The main event, though, you've seen it in our montage. I took a lot of videos and pictures of this particular match because it was fantastic. W3L Heavyweight Championship, Taylor Bryden defeated Luke King Sharp to retain the W3L Heavyweight Championship. It was a fantastic match. Phenomenal. Two excellent wrestlers who know their character. Taylor Bryden is... His character, it's weird because he's not particularly a charismatic or emotive person, right? But because he's that good of a wrestler when he comes to, he gets a bit aggressive, he can do kip-ups, he can do all these cool little things, crowd just love him. So I don't know how, because sometimes when you see wrestlers, like, oh, they're good at doing the fundamentals, basic wrestling, but the crowd don't care. But they like Taylor Bryden. So I don't know if he's just got this enigmatic quality about him that people just enjoy going, oh, he's a strong silent type kind of thing, but he's just a fantastic wrestler in this match. I showed it. Luke King Sharp, man, this guy, I think he's what, mid-20s, early 20s? And he's probably the most well put together wrestler in the country as an act and just as everything else. He's got character. He's a great brawling, he's a great wrestler, he's great at doing all those things, and he makes you care about matches, whether it's caring that he's scrappy-do, the absolute wrong-in who's been an absolute dick the whole time, and you want to see him getting smashed, or if he's the good guy, he's being the sympathetic babyface. He's that good that it's almost criminal that he's charging £5 at Iron Girders Wrestling to teach folk. £5, that is a steal. People should be going down to the LKS dojo to learn something from Luke King Sharp, because this guy, black book that makes him 7 foot tall, and he knows how to work a crowd. He knows what a crowd needs or what he wants in that moment and to get a reaction. This was a big brawl. Went to the merchandise stand, merchandise tail. My apologies. Went to the merchandise table. Went all over the place. It was just excellent. The lights went out, which is what I was talking about, Murray Fire turning up. The lights went out, so a portion of the match was being lit up by phone cameras, which is amazing with wee phone lights going on. And then the big lights came on, and then the spotlights came back on. Big light went off. Spotlight started doing some weird techno Morse code. So there was technical difficulties everywhere else, but the match itself was still phenomenal to watch. It was just an incredible match, great main events for the show, and hats off to both guys, because I was excellent. It was just fantastic. That's why I put it in our Match of the Month shortlist, because it was just a great match to watch, and fantastic advert for W3L when they come back in October. After the match, Looking Sharp threatened to hit Edith Summer with a kendo stick. You know, not that I wouldn't be unhappy about it. But the lights went off again. You know, technical difficulties. Oh no. Mike Musso's video came up. He started talking. I couldn't really hear it. I'm a little bit deaf. I'm a bit hard of hearing, so I couldn't really catch it. But the sentiment was there. Lights came back on. Mike Musso was behind Looking Sharp, grabbed his kendo stick, smacked him over the head with it, and challenged him to a match. So I'm thinking that'll probably be October. That'll be when we see them having our rematch. Last time they fought at Town Hall, it was Summer Spectacular, and it was wild. It was wild. Again, stuff went wrong, but it made it all the more chaotic in that particular evening. So looking forward to seeing them face off again. Looking Sharp went down to his pants for some reason in a fit of rage about being battered by Mike Musso. He took off his dungarees, took off his t-shirt, and somehow was at the top of the stage in his boots, his knee pads, and his pants, which, you know, that's just something you see at wrestling, isn't it? But it was a fantastic night at W3L. I'm looking forward to go back again. Like I said, hopefully I'm going to try and go in October. And what more can I say? A great start to the season. Technical difficulties on their end and my end aside with trying to edit all these episodes at the same time. It's going to be a fun season, I think. I'm really going to enjoy our road trip season of the SWN podcast. I don't think an episode will go out every week. At the moment, I'm doing the road trips will be Fridays, the interviews will be Wednesdays, and I'll letter them in between. So I think I've got, as of recording this bit, I've got episodes up until I've got Joey Legend on the 23rd. And then I think after that, yeah, because before that will be Battle of the Nations, WrestleZone Battle of the Nations. So there's August, I've got a good load of episodes. September, I've got two road trips, and I'm going to try and get some interviews on through the Zoom in the meantime. So fingers crossed we'll get some more interviews for you this season. At the moment, I think we've got a pretty good lineup for till the end of the year. And then once the new year starts, we'll probably go back to interviews and the odd road trip episode again. We'll just play by ear. That's what we do here at the SWN podcast. So for now, hopefully by this point as well, a little interview on Impact's Press Pass. I got a question on there. That would be quite cool. But if I haven't, this is a very awkward moment for me. But for now, hope you've enjoyed our first road trip of the season, on tour, SWN's podcast on tour. Go check us out, swnscotland.com, or go on to Twitter, X, Threads, Mastodon, whatever, at Scott Resnett, and you can find out more about what we do. So thank you very much for joining us. Have a good one.